Good morning and welcome to the Asian American and Asian Research Institute's co-sponsored book talk this morning. I'm Anthony Wong, program coordinator of the Institute. Today we will be hearing a presentation on Television and the Afghan Culture Wars, brought to you by foreigners, warlords, and activists, by Professor Wazhmah Osman from Temple University. Today's talk will be moderated by Professor Sumanth Inukanda from LaGuardia Community College. We're also joined today by his students in the computer lab at LaGuardia Community College this morning. Wazhmah Osman is an assistant professor in Temple University's Department of Media Studies and Production, and a faculty member in both the Master of Science in Globalization and Development Communication program and the PhD program in Media and Communication. She is a faculty affiliate of the Gender, Sexuality, and Women's Studies program, as well as South Asia Center at University of Pennsylvania. Professor Osman earned her PhD in 2012 from the University, where she studied media, culture, and communication. She is a graduate of the Culture and Media program in Anthropology. Her research and teaching are rooted in feminist media ethnographies that focus on the political economy of global media industries and the regimes of representation and visual culture that they produce. In addition to today's book, which she published recently, Professor Osman is also researching on how new technologies of war, violence, and representation predicated on old colonial tropes are being repackaged and deployed during the war on terror. Her critically acclaimed documentary, Postcards from Tora Bora, has been shown in festivals around the world. Please welcome Professor Osman.
Thank you very much, Anthony, for that great introduction. I have about 20 slides, and then we're going to leave plenty of time for Q&A and a discussion afterwards. I'm going to try to keep it short, focusing on some of the key aspects of my book. I also want to thank Suman for organizing, as well as Neetu and Kuhn from LaGuardia College, and Anthony from AARI, or ARI, the Asian American and Asian Research Unit, Institute, I'm sorry. So let's get started. I start with this image, which is a famous painting. This depicts the American settlers that came that were moving westward in the US. And the reason I do that is because people often ask me what drew me to write the book. And I start by saying that it was really how Afghan people, and I'm from Afghanistan, and it was the way that Afghan people have been represented in Western discourse. And from Rudyard Kipling to Winston Churchill, the prevailing image of Afghans has been of a people that are tribal, traditional, and barbaric. And these images in and of themselves are, highly racist imagery, which then impacts those communities that I'm a part of very negatively. This partially has to do with colonialism and the fact that Afghanistan has been at the intersection of imperial ambitions from the Great Game to the Cold War to the current US forever war that came to an end after 20 years in a very tragic way, which we can talk about in the Q&A. So Orientalism, which is a theory that some of the students may or may not be familiar with, but Orientalism and colonial mythologies, it's the way that people from the East are portrayed, has had a bearing on how people from Asia are represented in negative ways. And so this is not unique, this type of negative imagery and dehumanization of people to Afghanistan alone, but this is also the case for people from countries across Asia and the Middle East, which is sometimes called West Asia, as well as indigenous people, what are called First Nations people, Native Americans. All of them are oftentimes said to be savages. In the Trump era, which, you know, is a more recent era that many of you, I'm sure, can remember, these colonial mythologies were stoked again by him to stir anti-Asian sentiment and hatred, first with the Muslim ban and then with, you know, the coronavirus and the pandemic. He called it the China virus and so forth and so on, which led to all types of violence towards, you know, Asian American communities, including loss of businesses and so forth and so on. And so that's just the backdrop to what led me to write the book, because I wanted to show a different side of Afghans in Afghanistan. So this is an image of Chris Kyle from the film American Sniper, which is based on his memoir. He was an American sniper in the Marines, I believe. And in the book and in the film, well, no, not in the book, but in the film, they portray him as a very sympathetic kind of guy who has moral qualms about shooting at children. And in this scene in particular, he's targeting a child that supposedly has bombs strapped to him. But in his book, you know, this is a quote from his book, he's not a very sympathetic person. So this is an example of how after 9/11, you know, the tragic events and attacks on the World Trade Center and so forth, people from the Middle East and Asia were further stereotyped in mainstream media, as well as in popular culture and the news. And so the culture in Afghanistan was interpolated as static and fixed in time, so that, you know, it's always been that way and that they've always had these problematic traditions. But I knew, because of being from there and partially growing up there, that that's not the case, that all culture is dynamic and mutable, and sometimes cultures get regressive, sometimes they move forward, and that social movements and the media make a big difference in terms of moving culture backwards or forwards. So, you know, a little bit more background for you here. And then we're going to move on to this slide, which I think is important. And I call it the importance of contextualization. And where does fanaticism come from? Is it indigenous to the culture? Who fosters it? And the reason why I do this is because, you know, oftentimes the way the East and the West are set up is that they're set up in the mainstream and dominant media and in dominant discourse in general, including sometimes in academia, as that, you know, the West is a place where civilization comes from, where progress, where democracy, where all of these positive developments come from. And the East is where all the negative aspects of those things come from. You know, this despotism, dictatorships, oppression of women, so forth and so on. And this is the way, you know, and in particular with countries in the East that are Islamic, it's often said that, you know, Islam breeds fanaticism, right? So Laila Boulevard, who teaches at Columbia, and Timothy Mitchell, who's her partner, also teaches at Columbia, have been done really great work that shows the importance of that. So Laila Boulevard says that we need to be suspicious when neat cultural icons are plastered over messier historical and political narratives. So we need to be wary when Lord Cromer and British ruled Egypt, French ladies in Algeria and Laura Bush, all with military troops behind them, claim to be saving or liberating Muslim women. And Timothy Mitchell says, American financial and military support for the ultra-religious Afghan and Pakistani groups was neither random nor coincidental. When other governments move closer to the US, Egypt, Pakistan, and many others, their political rhetoric and modes of legitimation become avowedly more Islamic. So the reason why these are important is because, you know, we have in our mind that the, you know, US military goes in for good purposes and that the US is on one side and Islamic extremism is on the other side. But in reality, what happens is that much of the funding for these ultra religious groups comes from the US. And so these are ways of contextualizing that we often don't see in the media. So yeah, and both of them were professors of mine when I was a graduate student. So these are some examples of films that portray, you know, South Asian, West Asian, Middle Eastern people and in very negative lights. And they're highly popular and they have, they gross, hundreds of millions of dollars, right? So, and the critics oftentimes don't like them and find them to be very problematic, but the general population tends to talk with their money and they actively support these. So these are some examples of better ones. These are films that are, you know, show some of the messier complications and don't fall into this binary thinking of good, evil, you know, bad, things like that. And then this last group that I'll show you it's even smaller. So, you know, these are smaller budget. These are the very big budget ones. These are smaller budget. And then these are very, very small ones that are made by Asian Americans or what are called hyphenated Americans, people who have a foot both in their countries of origin, but also grew up partially here. So they go back and forth. So for example, Wounds of Waziristan is made by Madia Tahir, who is Pakistani American. This film, the FBI blew up my ice skates. And then this one's called Norman Schwarzkopf Made Me Gay, is by Sarazia Ibrahimi and Lindsay Martin. This is my film, Postcards from Tora Bora, that I made with Kelly Dolak. So she's Iranian American. So a lot of hyphenated people who've made smaller budget films, oftentimes through universities and things like that. These are the bigger ones, Dirty Wars, and so forth. So not all of them have the same type of circulation, but depending on budgets and what the content is. So moving along, in the interest of time, I wanted to bring in two other academics and professors who've been inspirational to my own work. And one was Faye Ginsberg, who was my PhD advisor at NYU. And so I'm not gonna read the whole thing here for you, but I just want you to have a sense of her concepts of what she calls cultural activism or activist imaginary. And she herself works closely with Indigenous and First Nations communities like the Inuit and Canada and the Aboriginal people and Australia and so forth. And she talks about the importance of people helping to train subaltern groups or people who are marginalized to make their own media. So, you know, she's created film festivals for people to come and for people, Indigenous media makers to have more opportunities to distribute and circulate their work, right? So if you're in positions of privilege and power and institutional, you have the institutional means to support those types of works that oftentimes don't get airtime and don't get circulated, that's something important to do. And then Edward Said, you know, is one of the prominent individuals, scholars who put Orientalism or the concept of Orientalism on the map with his book, talks about the importance of also working across your culture and race and gender and so forth. And I'll read this quote of his down here because I think it really emphasizes the importance of thinking about interconnections between all of us and how we can challenge and resist the hatred that's fueled through dominant media, and how we could make media and, you know, publish work that has a better sensibility and spirit of humanism. So Said himself was a humanist. So he writes, "It seems to me that unless we emphasize and maximize the spirit of cooperation and humanistic exchange, and here I speak not simply of uninformed delight or amateur's enthusiasm for the exotic, but rather of profound existential commitment and labor on behalf of the other, we are going to end up superficially and stridently banging on the drum for our culture in opposition to all other culture." Okay, so that's all some background of you know, theories and scholarship that's been important to me going into writing my book. But now I'm going to get into some of the concepts of my book. And I don't expect you to read all of that. But what I wanted to say is that, so I wanted to redirect the dialogue about Afghanistan back to Afghans themselves and how Afghan media institutions talk back to discourses pertaining to them that have been reverberating globally on an unprecedented volume and scale. How are charged issues such as gender and sexuality, human rights, democracy, and religion contested, framed, and negotiated by local cultural producers? This type of grounded work, along with rereading the archive, challenges the dominant top view of Afghans as tribal despots who are incapable of modernizing and nation building. So these are the media makers that I interviewed. You know, in post 9/11 Afghanistan, there was a proliferation of media and a boom in the media industry. There was, and particularly I would say with television and radio, because most people, because of so many years of war, are illiterate. You know, I interviewed these people on the left-hand side, and I've interviewed over 100 media producers. And most of the money for this rapid media proliferation came from what's called the international donor community, including the neighboring countries such as Iran, Pakistan, India, China, so forth. But most of the money came from Western nations. So let's get into some of the content. This is a picture I took of a US soldier guarding what's called a telecommunication tower. This is how much of the media is broadcast. Internet and digital media is not as important there because the infrastructure is not so good. And once again, there's high illiteracy rates. So what I demonstrate in the book is how the international community's interventions in Afghanistan have resulted in media imperialism. It's a concept we have in media studies, as well as yielding positive media development projects. So we can talk more about that in a minute when I talk about specific things, but I wanted to show the funding chart. Oh yeah, I also wanted, before I show the close-up of this funding chart, I wanted to show you that at the same time that the Western countries were investing in the media and all these really, you know, excellent media projects that had really important effects for the population, which I'll talk about, was happening, is that the war was ongoing. So on the one hand, you have Western development aid money that's improving people's lives. And then on the other hand, as you see, up until, this goes up until 2019, and I would say up until 2020, you know, you have this many bombs being dropped. And so the war was ongoing. So we have to put this into perspective, that the development that the international community and Western nations were involved in was happening at the same time that the war was ongoing. So this is a close-up of the funding chart, and it just shows where the money for the, and as I said, the US was one of the largest donors for nation building, and in particular, the media sector. So this is the funding chart that shows, you know, if you notice, most of the money comes from the DOD and then USAID and other agencies, and then the Department of State is the least. Whereas in the past, it was these two would spend most of the development aid, not this. But this is something that's shifted as well. All right, so let me move on to this one. In the book, I introduced two concepts, which I consider my theoretical contributions to the field. I call it the imperial gaze and the development gaze, in order to understand the complexities of the merger between development and imperialism. And indeed, they are two sides of the same coin. An imperial interest undermine the altruism of development projects and nation building. But I also think it's important to distinguish and differentiate between the two. So the imperialism projects have the more negative consequences here, as I've written, everything from you know, geopolitical dominance via resource extraction, election engineering, and so forth, and propaganda through the media. But the good development projects, which I talk about, are participatory and grounds up. So they're very collaborative with the people on the ground, and they take the interests of people who, Afghan people that these projects would be impacting into consideration in their design and implementation. So this shows some of the popular genres. So there's a lot of, and I should say there were a lot of imported dramatic serials, because now that Taliban are in power, they don't have as much imported serials, except from, you know, more Islamist countries. And then these are ones that were oftentimes produced without foreign aid. But I would say the majority of the media was produced with at least some form of foreign aid. So the out of the Western ones, the most popular ones were reality TV. Out of the imported serials, the Indian and Turkish dramatic serials or soap operas were very popular, which just goes to show that people need entertainment and fun in addition to more serious programming, especially in a place that's a war zone. So this is a shop owner in a TV store watching an Indian serial. As I said, they tend to be very popular. And then let's go to the next one is some of the other popular Dolhan, this one are popular Indian ones. I believe this was Tulsi. People, you know, would always be talking about them. And then this is the first Afghan serial that became very popular. Some of the other ones were not popular because they couldn't compete with the Indian one, since India has such a long history of making media and Afghan media has been interrupted over and over by war. But towards the end, before the Taliban takeover, this came out in 2018. It was very well made and had high production values. It's called Khat Sewam, about a group of people from different ethnic groups and different sects of Islam living in the same apartment complex in Kabul. So moving on to, these are some of the people, what I call the gun-toting villains, usually sister, mother, and aunt-in-laws, who scheme against the protagonist couple. So women found these characters, the villains of dramatic serials, to be particularly enjoyable and empowering, because they offer a subversive space for women to escape the patriarchal gaze. And then this is Sabah Sahar, who's an Afghan filmmaker. And she's also a police officer. She plays a powerful range of characters. She was targeted by the Taliban for an assassination about a year and a half ago, but she survived it. So moving on, we don't have many more slides. We're gonna be wrapping up soon. This is the reality TV show Afghan Star, which is the Afghan version of American Idol or Pop Idol and X Factor. And these were oftentimes the reality TV programs. Other ones were Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, Afghanistan's Got Talent. So there was all different ones. There was one called Dream and Achieve. And so they're oftentimes funded by Western NGOs or at Western government development money. So let's move on to the last set of genres that are popular, and that's the news, public information campaigns, political satire, and talk shows. And what I talk about there is that despite their modest production values, they are very popular with viewers because they serve an important function. Afghan audiences have a very high expectation of media and journalism, and the audiences want the media to bring justice and retribution to local and international warlords who have been sowing the seeds of war, gender violence, and sectarian strife. And with these programs, media makers uncover, investigate, and expose corruption and abuses of power and violence by local and international warlords and government officials. Here you have a program called Niqab, which means the mask. And, you know, women are given a mask to protect their identity, and they can anonymously talk about gender violence that they're experiencing in order to stir debate. It's a program called Open Jigga, which brings prominent individuals. So this was the former president who escaped before the Taliban takeover. And they let everyday people in the audience ask them questions. So once again, trying to make the country a little bit more democratic and elected officials be accountable to people. And then this is Farnaz Faratoon, who was a freelancer on multiple different TV stations, and she did interviews with prominent individuals, very hard-hitting, investigative kind of interviews into all kinds of issues. So she was quite popular, and she managed to escape with the Taliban takeover, and I believe she's in New York now. Last slide I have for you is these are all the people, all the media makers that have been killed and targeted because of the good work that they do. My conclusion is that for the last 20 years, Afghan media makers were developing and meeting Afghan people's high expectations. Without a doubt, the power of protesting and broadcast media was a very effective social tool for collective action in Afghanistan. But there was a huge cost to this emergence of a public sphere. Violence against media makers continues to be a big problem. They were subjected to threats, physical attacks, and death for providing people with programming they wanted to watch and needed to watch for a variety of reasons. And of course, this has become even more dangerous of a landscape for journalists and media makers ever since the Taliban took over. But it's important that we, you know, continue to pay attention to media freedom in countries throughout the world because it provides the counterbalance to government warlords and you know, other types of abuses of power and corruption and so forth. So I will end here and let's open it up to some Q&A.
Thank you, Wazhmah. Thank you very much for taking the time out to speak to us today.
Thank you, Suman.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your important work as well in this area. And yes, I would also like to thank AAARI, Anthony Wong, for sponsoring your talk and, you know, arranging the webinar, you know, the technology stuff, which is so important for us to be able to do it online. And I would also thank my colleagues, Neetu and Om, for you know, joining in. So you know, I would you know, listening to your talk, you know, there were some questions that came up, and some things that I was thinking about. So I guess we could start with that, and then open the conversation to the floor. I wanted us all to, you know, kind of get a better sense of what television is under Taliban right now. We see a wide you know, gamut of you know, genres and you know, quite a bit of activity on the media scene, which a lot of people for us, you know, it's kind of eye opening. You know, there's definitely imports, but you know, we've also heard of television channels like Tolo, right, and others who are doing news. So there is a wide variety, and you know, Afghan people's interest in these soap operas from India and Turkey, you know, that's fascinating as well. You know, now that Taliban is in power, and you know, it's also kind of heartbreaking that many of these you know, brave you know, media and you know, social activists were targeted at several points. What's television right now under, and what kind of challenges is the industry facing?
Yeah, thanks for that great question to start us off, Sumant, and for inviting me to speak with everyone. I agree with you. I think it's very heartbreaking because despite the problems that I talk about in my book with imperialism and militarism. The media sector was very successful, and there was over 50 broadcast channels, you know, supported by all different countries. And even though there was propaganda on these channels from the countries that were supporting it, because there were so many of them, they would actually create what we call a marketplace of ideas so that you can find the truth amidst all of it. So it's like if one channel was misreporting on an issue because they were funded by a certain country that didn't want that information out, there was enough other channels that the information could get out, which is a really important function of having a open media environment and a free media environment. You know, for example, in the US, you know, I'm a media scholar, and so we study these things. On the one hand, we have an open media environment, but on the other hand, it's very hard for new startups to get a license to be part of the, let's say, the cable networks or the major networks. You can become a startup online through YouTube or other means, but it's hard to get onto the network channels. And so in a place like Afghanistan, one of the positive developments was that it became possible for many people to have radio stations. And, you know, here you could become a, you know, podcaster and then, or create web series, and then you can get on TV or on the major networks. But there you could just go straight to the masses. And so to your question of what's happened to all of that now, that's something I'm exploring currently for some of my other research. And I'm still in touch with the people I interviewed. The lucky ones were able to get out after the Taliban, but many people are still there because they don't have the means or resources to get out. And most of the major companies, including Tolo TV, as you mentioned, which is the most popular one, and also, you know, received a great deal of U.S. development money through USAID. They're all still operational, but they are not. They're not open, meaning that there's a censorship. For example, many of the foreign programming from the neighboring countries and Western countries are not allowed anymore. Women have to be, you know, more covered up, but they're still allowing women to be on TV, but they just have to abide by quote unquote Islamic codes. You know, the only programming, foreign programming that they're still allowing is from places like Erdogan's Turkey, which is propagandistic and Islamist in its own way. So many of the programs from there that are being shown on Afghan TV are ones that look at the Ottoman Empire and have a nostalgic view of, you know, these great Eastern empires in their heyday, and they kind of erase any negative things that these quote unquote Eastern empires did, including things like, you know, the Armenian genocide and so forth and so on. And so those are the types of things they're allowing. It's heartbreaking, and I'm not entirely sure what's going to happen. There's talk of, you know, that they might collapse because of not getting enough international aid, which the Afghan economy was dependent on. So I'll leave it there.
Yes, thank you. Kaun has a question, I guess.
Yes, thank you very much. I mean, this is very like excellent to talk, because I am not so much aware of, you know, Afghanistan culture and the importance of media and et cetera. So very eye-opening talk, I really appreciate it. And I do agree with you when you said the importance of the roles of media for social, as a social tool for activism. It's so unfortunate that Taliban took over the country again, and then censorship and a lot of restriction has already begun. But based on the previous experiences, because the country was once ruled by Taliban, like prior to this recent one, and knowing the censorship and restriction back then, right? So based on that experiences, I'm wondering, what do you think would be the best direction that people could pursue despite this, you know, restriction and limitations for, you know, like media producers?
Yeah, that's a great question too. So you're absolutely right. This is not the first time that the Taliban are in power. You know, we call this time around that they're in power, Taliban 2.0, because they're trying to change their image to the international community that they're a kinder, gentler form of Islam. And in certain ways, that's true. In other ways, they're not. You know, for example, during Taliban 1.0, the first time around, they banned all media. You could be killed if you were found to even be watching DVDs at home, right? They were burning books. They were breaking TVs publicly. So nothing was allowed except their own Sharia radio. So now the media is operational. They just have to figure out how to go around the censorship codes. Now there was censorship during the 20 years that the Afghanistan was under the international occupation too, but not like this. This is a much more extreme form. And so one of the ways that people go about it sometimes is using satire, right? So if you look at Iranian cinema, which is similar to Indian media, we call them the powerhouses of the region. They have long histories of producing high quality media. And so with Indian media, they have had to produce media under the Islamic Republic of Iran for 40 years now. But the films do very well internationally because it's metaphor and it's satire and those types of things. So there are ways, but the problem also is, and this is similar to what's happening with Ukraine and Russia, is that in highly controlled media environments, it's susceptible to fake news and propaganda and things like that. So one thing I say is people in the diaspora like me and other people who are still have connections over there, it's important to make sure that people understand what's really happening, right? And the last thing I'll say is that the Taliban itself is not a monolithic group, because now there's many people who, there's more moderate people and there's more hardliners. So within them, there's a conflict, right? And they also are under extreme pressure because the international community, which gave most of the money, I would say between 70 to 80% of the gross income of Afghanistan, isn't doing that anymore. There's all kinds of sanctions. So maybe they won't last long. Maybe that's the best case scenario. But if it falls into more war or another civil war, which we've had, that's not a good thing, because, you know, the people are traumatized from, you know, close to 50 years of war now. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so I think, you know, audience members can raise their hands. Yes, Neetu has raised her hand.
Hi, Wazhmah. Very nice talk and important issues. And again, I am on the same page as others about what has happened recently in Afghanistan. It is very heartbreaking, and I really feel, you know, so sad. And think about those people who are still there, you know, about their situation. I wanted to talk about the economic impact in the articles, you know, I was able to read over the time. There was like limited funding, and, you know, there were banks, you know, that were closed and people couldn't withdraw the money. So I just wanted to know if you have any update about the economic situation of the people currently living in Afghanistan, and how they are managing, you know, their day-to-day expenses and their living, because that must be really, really, really difficult for them.
Yeah, thank you, Neetu, too. That's a great question as well. So, you know, I'm in touch with people over there. The situation is horrible. There is so much starvation and poverty. You know, people, let me put it this way. The international aid that was going into Afghanistan during the 20 years of the US NATO war was not going and being distributed evenly. So there was still a great deal of poverty, right? It was reaching more elite Afghans. But now it's an entire different situation. So many people are not getting their salaries from the government. People are having to sell their children. I mean, you know, some of it is also fake news, but some of it is real because I know, I'm in touch with people. There's a lot of widows in Afghanistan because of the war. And so for women who were the sole providers of their family, and sometimes they have to, you know, provide for very large families and you know, sisters and brother-in-laws and multiple generations living together. If the woman was the head of the household, which is the case, especially in cities which used to be more liberal and more progressive, and they're not bringing an income, it impacts so many people, right? So for example, they're allowing women in Kabul University and other universities to still go to university, but they're trying to make it gender segregated. And there's, you know, and it's creating difficulties in other ways. And they've also, you know, cut some of women's education and girls' education. You know, there's an opium crisis similar to the US, but much worse. So that's becoming, you know, it's just very dire and heartbreaking. And I feel like the media has moved on and not really talking about it. But the reports that are coming out of there and the level of people's desperation is unbelievable, you know. And so I'm part of an Afghan American, a few different organizations. We did some fundraising that we were successful with when the Taliban in August of this year, when the Taliban first came to power, because it was in the news, we got a great deal of donations, but now people are just not donating the same way. And Neetu, to your question of you know, how the sanctions and people in the US not letting Afghans get access to their money and in the central bank of Afghanistan is impacting it. I mean, that's the main reason. That's one of the main reasons, is that they are not distributing any of the allocated monies to Afghanistan. And part of the money they actually gave to 9/11 victims, which the Afghan American community was up in arms about, people were very angry about, right? Because even though we don't support the Taliban, it's not necessarily hurting the Taliban, it's hurting everyday people too. So it's a complex situation. But I'll say one more thing, which is, you know, I think this is an area that requires more research, because there's different types of sanctions. And I know, you know, you are an expert in economics and I am not, but you know, there's sanctions that I think might be effective in certain situations, but then there's sanctions that, from what I've heard, including in other parts of the world, that really hurt people more than the governments, right? And we need to look into it. It's like, are you sanctioning money to the government, or are there other ways that we can get money to people? And why are you withholding private people's money? So in Afghanistan, in addition to not giving the government allocated money that the UN was had negotiated, they're also not allowing private individuals to access money that was in central banks. So it's just kind of complicated and mind-blowing.
Yeah, thank you so much for that detailed response. I was just also curious if there are still people over there who want to get out but are unable to you know, after all that.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. There, I mean, it's like everybody wants to get out. They wanted to get out before too. It's not like people during the Western intervention times didn't want to get out. Everybody always wanted to get out. But now, you know, it's just very difficult, you know, and it's contributed to making the refugee crisis much worse. And now you also have refugees from Ukraine and other places. And so this is a bigger picture thing we need to look at, is that on the one hand, there's more and more anti-immigrant sentiment, right? So many places are creating these xenophobic policies that are saying we don't want more people from the East and what we call the global East and the global South to be coming to the global North and the global West. But on the other hand, many of those nations were involved in creating those situations, at least partially involved, and sometimes not directly involved, but definitely involved in creating, you know, the rise of Islamism and other situations that we find ourselves in today.
Yeah. Yeah, I also read some articles where, you know, people are coming out and protesting. And, you know, that is, I don't know what was the situation when Taliban was in power, you know, a long time ago. But that was something, you know, very brave of those people to come out, you know. So I hope, you know, things gets better. And, you know, as a community, we are able to, you know, create some awareness and are able to help those people in some way. Thank you.
Yeah.
So much.
Thank you. Yeah, no, it's true. People are protesting, but it is also at the first time around, people were not protesting because, you know, they were killing people left and right. And this time around, people have become accustomed to having certain rights. And so they don't want to go back. And they're, as you said, they're being very brave to protest.
Yeah.
Women's groups, ethnic minorities are under, who are under attack and so forth, are protesting. But, you know, I don't know how much longer they can if the international community's attention shifts, because partially, I think they're trying to present this better image and be, quote unquote, more tolerant because they think people are watching, right? And they still are trying to get access to the international money. So we'll see. Yeah.
Thank you so much. And thank you for your work. It's very important. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So, you know, sanctions have, definitely over the years we have seen with Iraq and other countries that they have these catastrophic humanitarian consequences. Yeah, but I wanted to ask a slightly more personal question. I wanted to ask if you would like to share some of your memories from Afghanistan, you know, either growing up or doing research, you know, things that make you hopeful, that can give us an idea of things in the culture that that we might not know.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I think we're running out of time, but
yeah.
I think you all are going to go and be in breakout groups, but I can share some memories. I also co-directed and co-produced the film Postcards from Tora Bora, which is available through most universities. That's about my family's experience leaving Afghanistan and me going back to the places that I remembered. I don't know if my memories make me hopeful per se, and it definitely makes me nostalgic and sad for what's been lost, because, you know, it takes a great amount of resources and time for countries, especially poor countries like Afghanistan, to get to a place of having a functioning society that's, you know, moving towards democracy, which is what was happening in the Afghanistan of my childhood, right? So I came here with my family when the Cold War happened and the Soviets invaded. But you know, what I remember is a progressive country. And I'm also, my family's from Kabul, and you know, that might be different because in all countries, there's a difference between urban and rural experiences. But yeah, so I went back to many places, and it was many of the places I used to go to as a child, whether it was parks or the zoo or other places, were, you know, fully destroyed or partially destroyed. And we have a family house that was taken over by a warlord. So none of it, you know, I would say makes me hopeful, but we'll see what happens. I mean, the only thing that maybe makes me hopeful is that I think that people did experience those times of relative democracy, both in the last 20 years and during my childhood. So hopefully the new generation of younger people will fight for that and not let it go back towards extremism, because the way the dominant media here frames it is that, you know, Afghanistan's always been like that. It was always stuck in time, and that they're just incapable of that, right? So if you don't believe you can change and you can be a better nation that's more inclusive, then you can't make those changes. And so what I'm hoping and seeing a little bit, both with the bravery of people who are fighting back there, and including the fault lines within the Taliban, is that hopefully we can move towards something better again. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, if you have time, you know, I had just one last question. I was looking at the slides.
Yeah.
And you know, you talked about the shift of investment from USAID to DOD.
Yeah.
I was wondering what that tells us. And also, you know, the bombs dropped. The curve was like a, you know, it's, I don't know, it, there were some ups and downs. Around 2015, there is a down. There are fewer bombs dropped. I was wondering what was going on then. So yeah, those are some of my observations. Some, you know, I was a bit curious about those things.
Yeah, and Sumant, what was the first part? The second part of
the first part was DOD. From USAID to DOD, what is that shift? What does that tell us?
Yeah,
investment into media.
Yeah, I think, you know, that's something that. I think similar to Nito's question, requires more research, because it's something I noticed that in the past, when the US would go into development of other countries, it was the USAID and State Department and other countries, but over time it's shifted. So even the development money is coming more from the DOD and from the military institutions. And so what that means, I don't really know, and I don't know why that shift has happened. I think it raises some question of why that is happening, right? Why are we not having more civil society approaches, right? And then to your question of the up and down curve, I'm not entirely sure, but I can say that sometimes people ask about that same thing when I've given these book talks, Sumant. And sometimes people think like, oh, the times where there's less bombs dropped on, quote unquote insurgents in Afghanistan, like the Taliban or ISIS or so forth. But, you know, we know that those are not the only people that get hurt in terms of the civilian casualties. But sometimes people think like, oh, was it under democratic administrations, right? And that maybe the higher amount of bombing was under more Republican administrations. And the answer to that actually is no, because it doesn't correlate with political parties here, because Obama statistically used more drone warfare and drone strikes than any other president before or after him, right? And so people are often surprised about that because we don't think of Obama as what's called a war hawk. He even made a statement at one point that, I'm surprised I'm very good at killing people. Something to that effect, I'm paraphrasing him. But then during the Trump era, you also had these very large scale bombs like the Moab, which was called the mother of all bombs, which is the largest non-nuclear bomb ever dropped on people. And it has a very large range, miles. I forget the exact numbers. I think like at least 5 miles that it damages, and it goes really deep, and it also damages the environment in terms of what's in it. I don't really know when it dropped. I think sometimes when the casualties get really high, then there's reports in the international press, and then they decrease it, and then it goes back up, right? So these are things that also require analysis, because, how effective was the strategy of these campaigns? Did it actually reduce terrorism, or did it increase terrorism because it, created so much uproar because of civilian casualties that maybe then more people would join these groups, right? So it's very complicated things to, I think, when I was writing my book, there was very few people doing on the ground research and thinking about it. So I kind of had to bring together a lot of different information, but I was really hoping that there was going to be more people going in to follow up on these things. But now, and when I was there, there was researchers from all over the world, because it was a bit safer, not completely safe, but a bit safer. But now people can't go to do research in the same way again, but maybe people could do research from here to figure out some of these questions. But I have to get going.
Yeah.
Good luck with the rest of your class. It was a pleasure meeting those that I haven't met before. And thank you, Sumanth, Anthony, Kuhn, and Neetu again for bringing me here.
Thank you
very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Professor Osman for a wonderful presentation, and Professor Unakanda for inviting the Institute to co-sponsor the book talk. You can purchase her book, Television and Afghan Culture, from the University of Illinois website, $28. Link is available on this talk's webpage. And thank you very much, Professor Osman.
Thank you all. Bye for now.